O God, when you went forth before your people, marching with them and living among them, the earth trembled, heavens poured down rain. Alleluia. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you. Good afternoon, everyone. This morning's, or this afternoon's Mass is offered for Jerry Lelko. As we come into the presence of the Lord this day, let's call to mind our sinfulness. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore I ask, Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and lead us to everlasting life. Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Let us pray. O God, who restore human nature to yet greater dignity than at its beginning, look upon the amazing mystery of your loving kindness, and in those you have chosen to make new through the wonder of rebirth, may you preserve the gifts of your enduring grace and blessing. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. A reading from the Acts of the Apostles. From Paphos, Paul and his companions set sail and arrived at Perga in Pamphylia. But John left them and returned to Jerusalem. They continued on from Perga and reached Antioch in Pisidia. On the Sabbath, they entered into the synagogue and took their seats. After the reading of the law and the prophets, the synagogue officials sent word to them, "My brothers, if one of you has a word of exhortation for the people, please speak." So Paul got up, motioned with his hand, and said, "Fellow children of Israel, and you others who are God-fearing, listen. The God of this people, Israel, chose our ancestors and exalted the people during their sojourn in the land of Egypt. With uplifted arm, he led them out, and for about 40 years he put up with them in the desert. When he had destroyed seven nations in the land of Canaan, he gave them their land as an inheritance. At the end of about 450 years, after these things, he provided judges up to Samuel the prophet. Then they asked for a king. God gave them Saul, son of Kish, a man from the tribe of Benjamin, for 40 years. Then he removed him and raised up David as their king. Of him he testified, 'I have found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. He will carry out my every wish.' From this man's descendant, God, according to his promise, has brought to Israel a Savior, Jesus. John heralded his coming by proclaiming a baptism of repentance to all the people of Israel. And as John was completing his course, he would say, 'What do you suppose that I am? I am not he. Behold, one is coming after me. I am not worthy to unfasten the sandals of his feet.'" The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord. Forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord. The favors of the Lord I will sing forever. Through all generations my mouth shall proclaim your faithfulness. For you have said, "My kindness is established forever. In heaven you have confirmed your faithfulness." Forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord. "I have found David, my servant. With my holy oil I have anointed him, that my hand may be always with him, and that my arm may make him strong. Forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord. My faithfulness and my mercy shall be with him, and through my name shall all his horn be exalted. He shall say to me, 'You are my Father, my rock, the God, my Savior.' Forever I will sing the goodness of the Lord." Alleluia, alleluia.
Alleluia.
Jesus Christ, you are the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead. You have loved us and freed us from our sins by your blood. Alleluia, alleluia. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. May the word of God be in our minds, on our lips, and in our hearts. When Jesus had washed the disciples' feet, he said to them, "Amen, amen, I say to you, no slave is greater than his master, nor any messenger greater than the one who sent him. If you understand this, blessed are you if you do it. I am not speaking of all of you. I know those whom I have chosen, but so that the scripture might be fulfilled, the one who ate my food has raised his heel against me. From now on, I am telling you this before it happens, so that when it happens, you may believe that I am. Amen, amen, I say to you, whoever receives the one I send receives me, and whoever receives me receives the one who sent me. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus. Well, we have brought down our beautiful wood carving, our statue of Mary, crowned Queen of Heaven and Earth. This is her month. Traditionally, we honor Mary during this month. We have a feast day coming up a week from right about now, I think. That would be the 13th. Has to do with the approved apparition at Fatima, which took place about 103 years ago. At the end of the month, we will be celebrating the visitation. Every now and then, we run across a passage from Scripture that has a particular significance for the person standing up here, the preacher man. Thinking of one Ezra and Nehemiah, the Jews had returned from exile in Babylon, and they're standing up on a platform, not unlike this, reading from the sacred scriptures from morning till noon. That was one heck of a homily. Do you suppose they allowed the people to sit down in their pews for a while? I don't know, but very, very big. And of course, it's real significant for me because that's exactly what's happening right here. Not too many people here today, but you know, you get the idea. But here's another example of what I'm talking about. In this particular case, from the Acts of the Apostles, the very, very new church, it's being called the Way because of Jesus being the way, the truth, and the life. It's Paul and probably Barnabas, Paul and his companions, it says. Remember that John was there. John has left them and returned to Jerusalem. This is Mark, John Mark. There's a disagreement between the two. But it's the Sabbath, and they enter into a synagogue and take their seats. And someone's invited Paul. My brothers, if one of you has a word of exhortation for the people, please speak. And so Paul got up, motioned with his hand, and said, fellow children of Israel. That's essentially what I'm doing right now. I motion, you know, the Lord be with you. And you responded, and with your spirit. And now I am exhorting you by utilizing the sacred scriptures and basically saying, in many respects, the same thing Paul said before the people of the synagogue on that day, speaking about Jesus, Jesus. I want to jump over to the gospel now, and you can expect me to kind of repeat myself a little bit here. Over the past few days, we've been talking about Jesus and his Father, God the Father. And I said something the other day, I'm not sure which one it was, about Thomas and Philip at the Last Supper kind of complaining or lamenting that they want to see the Father. They want to see the Father. I think they were expressing a desire that's deep within the hearts of all of us, that we want to see the face of God somehow. Might not be a literal face, but we want to recognize God's presence in our life in a special way. More than just believe, but to touch us in a special way. And I would say most of us have experienced that, some in more dramatic ways than others. I've often told you that I've never seen God, never heard God, never so much as sensed his presence in a tangible way, and nevertheless, the Lord has brought me to this place in my life that I would have never imagined for myself. So I guess you could say the Lord has revealed himself to me in a very special way. But I would say that we really love to see the face of God. And Jesus has said on more than one occasion, well, he did it right here. So that when it happens, you may believe that I am. It's capitalized in the scripture passage right here. I am. I am who I am. The title of God. But Peter, and I'm repeating myself again, is that not Peter, but Philip says, just show us the Father's face and that will be enough for us. And Jesus laments, Philip, Philip, have I been that long with you and you still don't recognize me? He's kind of speaking on behalf of the Father. Early this morning, spending some time YouTubing, and you know, sometimes things just kind of come up. takes me in a particular direction and kind of influences these words of exhortation that I share with you. And we talk about seeing the face of God, the literal face of God. If we're looking at Jesus, we are looking at the face of God. Where do we see the face of Jesus? Well, he's been represented in art in so many different ways, but you know, from what I've learned this morning on the YouTube, is his face was influenced by some very, very interesting things that are ancient, like how about the Shroud of Turin? For many years, the church venerated it, still does, as the face of Jesus. But they had the disadvantage of looking at a negative image. But when we had the gift of photography about 150 years ago, their negative became the positive image. And so we look upon the face of Jesus. It's the gospel. It preceded the gospel probably 60 years or more. The Shroud of Turin, there at the transition from death to life, death to resurrection. So we've got that. But the other one, and maybe this is, I know it's not nearly as well known, but I think many of you are familiar with it, is called the Veil of Monopello. The Veil of Monopello. There is a EWTN special. I was able to watch it this morning. It's called Vaticano, and it's the story about the veil. Let me show a picture of it. Come on. There it is, okay. The Veil of Monopello. Imagine this in a frame up here above an altar with a window behind it. You don't see that image. You're seeing the window behind it. That image is on a fabric that is so thin that it's almost, you can't even almost touch it. You all know what silk is. It comes from a silkworm. This comes from it's kind of a silk. It's called sea silk, and it comes from a little mollusk, a little creature from the ocean. They showed a picture of it. It's as thin as silk. Somehow they wove it into this fabric, and there's an image on it. And you can only see it if you illuminate it from the front. And so what kind of sense can you make out of something like that? How did they make it? The only thing I could imagine would be with an airbrush. But they didn't have airbrushes a couple thousand years ago, 100 years ago, whatever the case. So how do they do it? I think it's just another one of those gifts that come from heaven from time to time. It's one of the ways we look at the Shroud, Our Lady of Guadalupe image, and maybe even the Veil of Monopello. So God gives us these little gifts that enable us to look upon the face of God. So we've been given that opportunity. Let's not take it for granted. As disciples of Jesus, let us place our prayers before the Father, trusting in his goodness and love. For the church, may the joy of the gospel inspire us as missionary disciples. Let us pray to the Lord. For all leaders of nations and peoples, and for the resolution of conflicts among them, we pray to the Lord. For all who are coerced, are in coerced or forced service to another, may the Lord rescue them and instill in them an assurance of their human dignity, we pray to the Lord. For this community of faith, Holy Spirit, may Christ enable us to know him more and more, and may this knowledge inspire us in our service to one another, we pray to the Lord. For all who have gone before us in faith, especially Jerry, for whom this Mass is offered, may they all be rewarded for their service in God's name, we pray to the Lord. And for all of our brothers and sisters, sick or hurting in any way, body, mind, or spirit, may Jesus, the great physician, along with his mother, along with Joseph, with all the saints of the church, bless them, restore them to health according to his holy will, we pray to the Lord. I'd like to pray that prayer we've been praying. Almighty and merciful God, source of all life, health, and healing, look with compassion on our world brought low by disease. Protect us in the midst of the grave challenges that assail us, and in your fatherly providence, grant recovery to the stricken, strength to those who care for them, and success to those working to eradicate this scourge. We pray through Christ our Lord. Amen. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received this bread we offer you. Fruit of the earth and work of human hands, it will become for us the bread of life. Blessed be God forever. Through the mystery of this water and wine, may we come to share in the divinity of Christ, who humbled himself to share in our humanity. Blessed are you, Lord, God of all creation, for through your goodness we have received this wine we offer you. Fruit of the vine and work of human hands, it will become our spiritual drink. Blessed be God forever. Now with a humble spirit and a contrite heart, may we be accepted by you, O Lord. May our sacrifice in your sight this day be pleasing to you, Lord God. Wash me, O Lord, from my iniquities. Cleanse me of my sins. I pray, my brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice
May our prayers rise up to you, O Lord, together with the sacrificial offerings, so that purified by your graciousness, we may be conformed to the mysteries of your mighty love. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and just. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, at all times to acclaim you, O Lord. But in this time above all to laud you yet more gloriously, when Christ our Passover has been sacrificed. For with the old order destroyed, a universe cast down is renewed, and integrity of life is restored to us in Christ. Therefore, overcome with paschal joy, every land, every people exults in your praise. And even the heavenly powers with the angelic hosts sing together the unending hymn of your glory as they acclaim. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, he broke it. He gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when the supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The the mystery of faith. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity together with Francis, our Pope, along with Benedict, Earl, our Bishop, with Carl, our Deacon Jerry, Deacon John, Father Richard, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. Today we remember Jerry and Father Paul and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, the Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her spouse, with the blessed apostles, with Saint Paul and Barnabas, John Mark, our patroness, Saint Philomena, and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Amen. Now, at the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, miserere nobis. Agnus Dei, qui tollis peccata mundi, dona nobis pacem. Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. We're doing our best here at Holy Spirit to make sure that for those of you who are at home watching this on live streaming, that it's the best you can get. We've got these new little microphones. They're called Bluetooth technology. Yesterday, one of our gurus, our technical geniuses, found a way that gets fed through the sound system, so we don't have to worry about that little microphone that presented some problems. For those of you watching at home, if there are any glitches, please let us know, as you always do. This afternoon, I'm going to be going off to Jackson, to St. John's Church, to attend the viewing, part of the funeral process of our former pastor, Father Paul Cummings. Tomorrow's funeral is limited to just the bishop and the family members, so I will be going there representing all of you. I might see some of you there this afternoon, but in any case, we want to give Father our deepest respect and thanks for his many years of service here and throughout our diocese as a priest. Behold, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Alleluia. Let us pray. Almighty, ever-living God, who restore us to eternal life, in the resurrection of Christ, increase in us, we pray, the fruits of this Paschal sacrament, and pour into our hearts the strength of this saving food, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go and announce the gospel of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Saint Michael, the archangel, defend us in battle. Be our protection against the wickedness and snares of the devil. May God rebuke him, we humbly pray. And do thou, O Prince of the heavenly host, by the power of God, cast into hell Satan and all evil spirits round about the world seeking to